Blog Talk Radio.
We going up, or just going down? It's just a matter of time until we're all found out. Take our tears, put them on ice. 'Cause I swear I'd burn the city down to show you the light. We're the therapists, pumping through your speakers, delivering just what you need. Wear it and poise, we're the best boys.
Hey, what's up? This is the Independent Corner with Jonathan Moody. I'm here doing the show, and I was just over at Chris Neary's show, where you can see it at blogtalkradio.com/Chris Neary Rocks Your Soul. It was a really good show, a lot of fun. Chris is a good guy, and hopefully some of you guys go check that out too. He had some technical difficulties, but I'm sure the next show that he does will be a smashing success, so... Rock on, Chris Neary, rock on. So, let's see. We should be having Alan Wilbanks calling. He is the director of the hit independent movie that you can buy at pretty much any video store. So, my local video store, and we don't get that many. Oh, here he is. It's Alan Wilbanks. Hold on once. Alan, you're on.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, hey, what's up, dude? How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Who do we have on the call?
It's just me and you for right now. My friend Chris might be on later.
Okay,
kind of just introducing yourself, you know.
Okay, so, where do I need to pick it up from then, or do I need to pick it up?
Well, I said, actually, I don't even think I said the name of the movie yet, Motorhome Massacre.
That's
which is
one.
A fantastic movie. No, I really, really, really enjoyed it.
Well, and, I appreciate that very much, John. That's very kind of you.
After reading like some of their interviews and reviews and things, I don't understand, you know, how people can't get it. You know,
it's very weird. Like I don't know. Some people, you know, take it very seriously and think it's going to be a very serious film. And I mean, it is what it is. You know, we built it from the ground up to be, you know, a throwback to the days of the '80s and the slasher films. And it's more of a tribute to that, and a lot of people are not taking it the right way, but that's okay.
Well, it's an homage, tribute, and it almost seems like a parody in a way.
It is. It is a complete parody, exactly. And it's so funny because a lot of people pick that out, even on their reviews, and they pick that out, but they don't understand even what they're saying because they go, well, these guys are stereo cardboard cutouts. Or stereotype cut of the 80s slasher films. I'm like, yes, exactly right.
Right. So. Hold on. I've got my co-host on the show. Hold on one second.
Sure.
He's coming on. Hey, Chris, you're on?
Hey. I am on, baby.
Hey, what's going on, man?
What's happening, dude?
We're talking to Alan Wilbanks.
Awesome. How's it going, man?
I'm good, Chris. How are you doing?
Doing great. Doing great.
Fantastic. Where are you guys located at, by the way?
I'm located in Houston, right outside of Houston, Texas.
Cool.
Yeah, I'm
all
actually
right.
Closer to you, Alan. I live in Virginia.
All right, cool. I was just in Texas last week, actually. I was in San Antonio.
Nice. Yeah, that's a pretty cool city. I like it.
Very cool city, man. That little river walk they have down there during the holidays is very pretty. So
yeah, very nice. Cool. So, Alan, where are you at?
I'm in Atlanta, Georgia.
Oh, nice. Actually, I was just there, and just this past Thanksgiving.
Oh yeah, you have family out here?
Yeah, I got my in-laws out there, and yeah, we went and visited, and it's pretty nice out there. I like it.
The weather's okay. I mean, as far as culture and stuff, you know, it is what it is. It's a big growing city, and I've been here my entire life, and I love this city, but it doesn't have a lot of the history of the city doesn't have a lot of the cool old buildings and stuff, but it's still a very very nice city, very very lovely to be here.
Awesome. Nice.
Cool. Chris wasn't able to actually check out Motorhome Massacre yet, but he said
I didn't get a chance to. But, yeah, I'm going to check it out.
Well, according to Jonathan, it's highly recommended. So.
Cool. Awesome.
Yeah, it's a very campy, very, you know, I mean, to me, it's definitely a throwback to all the, you know, 80s slasher films. And
awesome.
You know, it's, you know, if you like, you know, because even Friday the 13th, in a way, didn't take itself so seriously.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, and that's what I think is with Motorhome Massacre is that, I mean, you didn't come up with that title, right, Alan?
Yeah, I came up with that title.
You did?
Yes. I did, yeah.
Was that the original title or?
That was the original title, yeah.
Okay.
I can kind of tell you a little bit about how that came about if you want.
Oh, sure. Sure. Go right ahead.
Okay. Well, I had a motorhome, actually, and I bought this 1975 motorhome. A friend of mine had the same year model, and he's like, hey, man, why don't you get one? We'll all go traveling around. And I was like, hey, that's a great idea, and ended up finding one and bought it down in Orlando, Florida, where I think all the RVs go to die. And I went down there and picked it up and drove it back, and, man, the thing broke down. I can't tell you how many times it broke down coming back from Orlando. But, anyways, got it back to Atlanta, and a few months after, you know, I got it, I thought, you know, what can I do? What could be cool to do with this motorhome? And so I started writing a movie around it. So that's how we came up with it. So I came up with a whole bunch of names. I had a list of probably like 30 names that I came up with. And Motorhome Massacre just seemed to kind of roll off the tongue, and I think it'd be a real good job, you know, good idea to make a campy kind of horror flick with a I mean, nobody's ever had a motorhome in their I mean, like the title, I don't think, in a movie. So I thought it'd be kind of cool to do that. So,
Can you give us a couple of names of the list of like names off the top of your head that you would have came up with other than that, or do you remember?
Wow, you know.
Or do you not like to talk about?
I don't even remember the names now. I mean, I wrote them all down. I should hold on to some of that stuff. Maybe I can dig that up sometime and maybe email it to you. But it was a whole list of stuff. And, there was a couple of them that just kind of stood out, and I finally just went with that one. I thought it was a cool one.
Oh, and it's a great title. So, I mean, I was afraid that maybe, I mean, you had come up with something else and then the studio changed it, and maybe you had come up with something even better, you know. But I'm glad that it was yours because it was a good title.
That was one of the things that when they started looking at it, they were, you know, they always threaten to do that. They always say, you know, we're thinking about changing the title of this or whatever. And that's something that you just have to kind of relinquish if that's the case. If you sell your distribution rights to a company, that's one of the things they kind of put in the clause is they had to market it. And they reserve that as under the pretense of like it being, you know, a conflict or something like that with another movie title. But I was pretty adamant. I tried to, you know, I said, look, you know, I think this is a really good title, guys. I think you guys should use it. And I made sure that it didn't conflict with any other title out there. And, I mean, it was really free and clear as far as that goes. There's nothing even similar to it. So they went ahead and went with the title, and so that was a win for me, anyways. I think.
Definitely. Yeah, definitely, I liked it. So, and I think that might have been also the thing that, you know, when I was going around before I even like I knew about you, I actually heard about you through you know, a guy named Richard Clark. He's from South Carolina.
Man, you know, I don't, and I feel bad, but my memory.
He had
not
talked to you
good,
through
so.
Email, so but he had done a he's doing a movie called Grindr.
Okay, all right.
He had mentioned that about you know about your movie and about your stuff, you know, about the reviews and everything, and we actually read, you know, the thing on the air, you know, on the show, on one of the shows he was on, right, Chris?
Actually, yeah.
Yeah, so Chris was here that night, and so we ended up doing that, and it was, you know, it was really cool. You actually told the guy that was kind of dissing your stuff, you know, off in a subtle way, but not in a mean, like, nasty way, but in a subtle, I'm smarter than you and kind of way, you know?
Well, you know, it's so funny. These review guys, I think, you know, it's very popular right now to try to come out and really bash a film in a creative way, you know, and that's something that seems to be pretty prevalent on the web. If you do not like the film, then they will make sure that they come up with a real clever way of making people kind of laugh or whatever about their writing. And I think that some of the reviews that are out there are that's why they're kind of like that, because you know, if it's a really good movie, I mean, there's only so many ways you can say it's good, you know, and if they like it, there's only so many ways they can say they like it. But if it's a bad movie, they can go on and on, and they can make things really, you know, puff things way out of, you know, way out of order. And that's one of the kind of unfortunate like that, because they do make you laugh when you read them, but you have to realize that there are a lot of people that probably worked on that project and that, you know, deserve maybe a little bit more cred than what they're given, because the film got distributed, you know, and so that's one thing that a lot of people are, you know, don't take into consideration, that you know, that it was better than the hundreds of others that they looked over, you know, and so it did get distributed.
Right, right. And, I mean, and not just by, like, you know, pretty much you could do a direct-to-video thing, you know.
Right.
There's a lot of direct-to-video distribution for horror movies these days anyway. And, you know, I've talked about that before. A lot of people have, you know, argued with me and said that, you know, distribution is hard and blah, blah, blah. But I'm like, you know, if you think about all the, you know, there is some crap that's out on, you know, video, you know, these days that are being distributed, you know. And I'm not going to say any names because I'm not mean like that, you know. But,
right.
But you know, there are some people that, you know, distribute stuff that aren't that great. And then, yet, people complain, and then when something's good, then they still complain. You know what I mean? Like, it's just horrible. It's like, I don't know. You know, I just don't understand it. I mean, people are out there, they're doing their movie, right? I mean, you went out, you made a movie, you finished it, you know, and that's actually the hardest part, I think, about doing a movie, is actually getting started and then finishing it, you know?
Sure, absolutely. And I mean, what you're saying, I mean, it is a big task to undertake. There's a lot of facets to getting something like that done. But I do think, like, the review guys, they feel like it's their job to entertain people and their reviews, as opposed to really give a real good, like, solid review over it. And, you know, a lot of the people that are out there, I've had the chance to, you know, to ask them, like, you know, via IMDb or whatever, some guys get on those threads. And I actually go in the threads and, I ask, somebody will say, hey, you know, I hated this movie. And then I'll post back, and I say, well, I appreciate you even watching the movie. Can you tell me what you didn't like about it specifically, so we maybe make a better movie next time? And it really throws people for a loop, because I've had this happen several times where guys will come back and go, you know what, it wasn't nearly as bad as all that, and these are the things that I liked about it. And they'll even list the things I like, and they'll say, these are the things I didn't particularly care for. But other guys won't even post back, you know, because they just say, you suck or whatever, and I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, and that's that kind of attitude there. Or, I mean, I've even had people, you know, talk about your mama or whatever. And that, when you start getting into that kind of thing, then you know what kind of person you're dealing with, and you go, okay, I kind of can discount whatever you are saying here, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Like, I mean, I think that especially, like, you know, the Internet Movie Database and, like, online, it's like people are just kind of, you know, they take the, you know, the anonymous qualities of the Internet and just kind of use that as, like, just being loud and obnoxious. And they just kind of, you know, pound. I mean, yeah, I noticed that with, like, you know, horror movie threads and whatnot. I mean, it's like horror movie fans are, like, really, really, I noticed they're, like, really passionate about, you know, what they're talking about, and they just, like, you know, sometimes if they don't like something, they'll just scream it to the high heavens on the Internet.
And it's easy to do. Yeah, it's easy to do when you're anonymous, too, on the Internet. And that's the thing. When you've got to take some of that stuff with a grain of salt and go, okay, A, this is, like, somebody's opinion, and then B, this person is so anonymous. They're not going to ever face the filmmaker or anybody else. And so they're just kind of doing their thing. And what you'll do is, if you look, especially on the Internet Movie Database, you go through back some of those guys' threads, and you'll see that a lot of their stuff is negative. And that's when you can really call somebody out, when they just post, like, a million negative threads, and you go, look, you know, if you guys want to take a look at this guy's other threads, it might be of interest, because they're all negative. And so if there's a, you know, this guy maybe not have as much cred as he looks like he does, you know?
Yeah.
So, anyway.
Like, it's just like someone really loud and vocal just looking to diss something.
Exactly. I mean, it's just stupid. It's you know, I think Kevin Smith, you know, kind of pointed that out the best in Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. You know, have you guys seen that? Both of you guys have probably seen it, right?
Yeah,
Yeah.
Which one?
It's Jane Silent Bob Strike Back.
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah, well, you know, with the whole internet angle right there.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
So I thought that was really funny that they were, you know, pretty much they were doing, you know, where they got to meet up the people who, you know, the anonymous people. They found, they tracked these people down, and then they beat the crap out of them, you know. And I just think that would be great. That's a filmmaker's dream right there, you know. Meet all the 15-year-old kids who, you know, post nasty things about you that don't even really know anything about you. Just be able to beat the crap out of you.
I'll mention one more thing on this, and I guess we could probably, I mean, if you guys want to move on, whatever, but, like, there was this one other guy that was on there, and he was talking about, you know, low-budget movies and that, you know, that it's, that we should be able to produce a better movie than this or that or whatever. And I said, well, what do you consider, like, you know, he started talking about Robert Rodriguez, who, I mean, I think to everybody that has ever done a movie on his own, Robert Rodriguez is a god. I mean, in my opinion, I think he's, like, one of the best directors that we have here. And it's not only because of who he is and what he's done, but, like, he does it almost all by himself, and he does it in Austin, you know, not in Hollywood. Yeah. And it's just amazing, you know. He just has the fortitude to do all that stuff, from composing to directing to the whole thing, editing.
Yeah.
But anyways, you know, he mentioned, you know, El Mariachi, and, you know, I said, well, look, you know, El Mariachi got a lot of press, but the version that we all saw was about $250,000 version, and they say that right on the Internet Movie Database. If you get a little trial version or whatever, you can go on and see how much these movies were, you know, made for. And that's the movie that we all got to see. We didn't get to see the $7,000 version that he put together, you know. And then he goes, well, he also did it with Desperado. And I was like, well, Desperado is a $7 million movie. And he said, exactly. See, there you go. And, I'm, you know, that's not a low-budget movie to a lot of people that are out there producing these things today. It's just, I mean, $7 million is a lot of money. And anybody that thinks that $7 million is chicken fee, you know, to go out and make a movie, if you can raise that, then more power to you, you know?
Yeah.
You know what? I actually had a conversation with Josh Becker. I don't know if you know who that is. He's a filmmaker who did, Thou Shalt Not Kill Except and Running Time and Alien Apocalypse.
Right.
Right. Well, I had a conversation with him on Monday morning, and we were just talking on the radio. And one of the things I mentioned was, you know, I'm trying to raise a movie, raise enough money for a movie that's going to be costing basically $10,000. Basically, not even due to much of the thing, but mainly due to, you know, flying people in from different places and stuff, you know. I mean, that's going to be, you know, that's going to be the pain in the butt. And, you know, I was telling them I'm doing a horror movie for $10,000, but people look at me and go, $10,000? That's it?
Right.
You know? And then he was like, yeah, exactly. And then you try to raise enough money for a movie that costs $100,000, and then they're like, $100,000, that's it? And you're like, well, it's so hard to freaking raise $10,000.
Yeah, exactly. I know, man. You try to go out and, I mean, exactly right, man. You're absolutely right. People, it's just funny because they, you know, all right, this is the one thing I do try to tell people here in Atlanta when I go out and I speak to folks and stuff. The thing that Hollywood has done for so long, and they're so good at it, is they throw out these big budget numbers, and they throw out, you know, $200 million, $300 million, whatever, for a certain project. And what you don't know as a fan is that half of that money is spent on P&A, print advertising. So that kind of cuts their budget right in half. So that $300 million movie may have had $150 million in the budget. Then you've got the big stars, which all are, you know, getting $20 million a piece now, so you can whack that down a little bit more. So all these budgets get, you know, whacked down, but the reason they throw out these big budget films and the big budget numbers is so the guys like us that are producing films that are indie films, they automatically put us in a different category, okay? They put us like, that's crap, because you didn't have $100 million to do your film, then that must be a crappy piece of film, you know. And they do that on purpose, and that is because, and that really is a thing that if you know, there's been so many examples that have proven that theory wrong, but yet people still want to go out and see the Pirates of the Caribbean and all these other films, and they compare it to an indie film that has a smaller budget, and it's just not really fair, you know?
Look at all the classics. Look at Casablanca. How much did that cost? I mean, that did not cost $80 billion or $80 million even.
Right.
You know, it cost probably in the thousands just to produce that movie. I mean, something like that. It was probably not, I mean, maybe $100,000 or something like that. It was probably pretty cheap, you know? And that was what made all the classics great. They relied on story and structure and actual, like, you know, something you care about than on, like, cool special effects.
Well, if you look at, like, Alfred Hitchcock, I mean, you look at Rear Window, you look at Lifeboat, you look at all of his films, not all of them, but, I mean, most of his films were shot in just one or two locations. And you know, he had a courtroom drama. I think he did. Maybe he didn't do 12 Angry Men, but the thing is, you've got these films that have been classics, like what you're talking about, that are done in one or two different locations, and that's it, man. And when you can do that as a filmmaker, that is like pure genius, man. And that's why Hitchcock will stand the test of time. It's not because, you know, he has a gorilla running through, a 50-foot gorilla running through the streets of New York, you know, that's digitally produced. It's because he put together a drama that we all can be attached to and we can all identify with. And that's exactly. If you can do that, man, that's really good. That's really hard. Yeah, you know?
What you have to do is you have to come up with a good story first, something that you want to tell.
Yeah,
and
you
obviously
story,
you did. You came up with something you were interested in. Other people seeing. I mean, didn't you make this movie thinking this is your movie? This is a movie you go and see?
Yeah, you know, this is a movie, you know, Motorhome Massacre was a movie that it was, at the time, meant a lot to me, you know, and there was a lot of things that were happening in my life that, you know, I was like, okay, I'm going to, you know, have a lot of this stuff that's going to come out in the movie are things that are happening either in my life or things that have happened, you know, in my life at some period of time. And I think that's, you know, what they tell you to do is write about things that are personal to you, and that becomes actually easier to do, you know, because you can just throw things in at will that are very familiar. I wanted to watch this film in a lot of ways. I think that there was a lot of reasons why I made it. And so, you know, in the long run, you have to kind of, like you said, be true to yourself, make the movie you want to make. But you also, I think, one of the most important things for filmmakers starting out is to make something that's marketable, and making something that is it will get out there. And you know, you've got to have certain things in your films at this budget or these lower budgets, and you have to, you know, if you have those certain elements in there. And you think about the distribution before you start shooting, before you even start writing it, you've got a lot better shot at getting a distribution deal at the end, you know?
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah. I'm looking at the IMDb, like, you know, the board post, I guess, you know?
Sure.
And there's somebody brought up something. I guess you didn't answer it yet, but somebody else answered it, or said that they think. You know, was the question about the camera. What camera did you use?
This is the thing. And I found this out in Cannes. We were out there. And it's something that there's a reason why I don't answer every single question out there. And there's a couple of questions I don't answer. Some of the technical aspects of what I've done, what I did with Motorhome. And maybe I'll be more forthright with that later on in my career. But the thing is, what I try to do is we're still in negotiations with doing foreign distribution. We've already got, obviously, the North American thing is locked down with Lionsgate. But what you want to do when you're out there selling these things is you want to present the best possible look that you can for the film, okay?
Right, exactly.
And so what you want to do is we shot it in a certain way that
you don't want to talk about it.
Well, no, we shot it the best quality that we felt like we could shoot it in, okay? And the thing is, what you want to do is as a filmmaker, you want to make sure that it's the buyer, okay, of these films and these different markets or whatever, that puts the price on it for you, okay? So you don't want to say, oh, yeah, we shot this way or we shot this way, because they'll automatically put you in a certain category and go, well, it wasn't, you know, this, and it wasn't 35 millimeter, you know, or it wasn't this other kind of camera, whatever. And so that when you start getting into those pedantics, then they use those as chop blocks against you. It's like buying a used car. You know, you have a used car and you're trying to sell it to a guy, and the guy goes, well, you know, it's got a dent in it right here, you know, and it's got this many miles on it, or it's got this here or whatever, and they use those as little dickering points or whatever you want to say, call them, to bring you down, you know, and so that's why I don't necessarily discuss all the technical aspects. But again, like you're talking about, maybe if I get a little bit further on in my career and we can, you know, it doesn't matter what kind of camera I use, then I can talk about stuff like that.
Okay, so you don't want to ruin it before, you know, foreign sales and stuff, you know, right? Like, for marketing.
That's exactly right. And I think that's one of the things that, and again, I'm going back to that whole thing about with the, you know, the big budget Hollywood guys. You know, they always say, well, we use this fake camera, we use this camera or that or whatever. And, you know, they do that for a reason, because they want to set themselves apart from, you know, the guys that are making independent films that are doing just as good a job, but maybe don't have the high end. They can't afford the stuff, you know, basically.
Right.
And so if you want to try to keep your film in that same market with those other guys, because when you go to the Blockbuster, you go anywhere else, the films are the same price. You know, you go in there and they're all $20 or whatever they are. So that's what makes theirs differentiate. Because they, you know, have this or that or whatever, you know, associated with their film. That's what they get, the $100 million budget, and that's what they're banking on, that you will pick that film over somebody that did a lower budget indie film, which may be just as good or even better comparatively with the story, you know? Yeah.
Exactly. Did you read Robert Rodriguez's book, Rebel Without a Crew?
I have read that book about 30 times. And then
you must have learned from him the same thing that he kind of picked up early, which was when he was trying to sell El Mariachi, his trick was to not tell them the budget of the movie, which was $7,000. He didn't
want
to tell them that, because when they saw that, they'd be like, they'd give him like, you know, $7,001. You know,
exactly.
Like
if
that,
they'll give you half. They'll give you a third, man.
They will not give you enough money to pay back your investors or whatever you used. So,
Exactly right, man. And, you know, it ended up working out for him, because he ended up getting a Columbia deal, and, I mean, it ended up working out really good for him because he got the right spin on it at the right time, you know. And today, I mean, today you tell somebody you did, you know, shot a movie for, you know, $10,000 or whatever you shoot it for, it's pretty almost expected now, because that's because he set the standard, you know, and it's so easy for us now, you know, as filmmakers, to go, that's the way you do it or whatever, you know?
Yeah, I mean, he wrote a book that kind of gave you, in a way, the, you know, it was a guidebook,
yes,
basically, of how to succeed.
Absolutely. He gave you the guidebook, but, you know, the more important thing is that worked for him, that whole, like, low-budget thing worked for him then. But today it's really, really hard for somebody to, because that's not their calling card. You can shoot one for $10 and nobody cares anymore. You know, it's about the quality, it's about the story.
Yeah, it's become that. Like, originally when he was making it, it was all about, oh my God, you did that? And nowadays,
yeah,
especially with the advancement in digital video or whatever, you know, and HD and 24p, people are going out there making things that look, you know, they have to look the best. Because if you shoot a mini DV these days, it looks horrible, you know, and people don't want to buy that, you know. They want to buy whatever people are going to actually want to watch, you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, it is about everybody is discriminating viewers out there. There are a huge fan, legions of fans actually, that watch the horror films and that really get a kick out of buying them or watching them, you know, renting them or whatever, and laughing at them or just having a good time with them, you know.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that we try to capitalize on with Motorhome, is like take that kind of mentality and go, all right, let's just have fun with this film. Let's not take it too seriously. Let's make this a fun film to watch with a bunch of friends. And that's exactly what I set out to do. And I think we hit the nail on the head, you know.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you know, it definitely was campy, fun, and goofy, you know. Yeah, there are points where I was laughing my ass off, and there were points where I was actually jumping out of my seat.
Wow, okay, that's cool.
Yeah.
We had, you know, it's funny, you know, I think the interview you mentioned earlier was from Bum's Corner, I think, probably.
Yeah, I think that was it.
Okay, and the guy, you know, one of the things I mentioned in there is that we had 700 people actually come out to the premiere that we had here in Atlanta. We had actually two showings. We had a theater that held 400 people, so we had the first show and then we had the second one. And it is so weird when you've got 400 people in a theater, and I know you guys go to movies all the time. If there's 30 people in a theater, it's a big deal, you know?
Yeah.
So today, if you've got 400 people sitting in a theater, that means every seat's taken, okay? And it was crazy to watch it with that many people, because one subtle little thing here, if somebody starts laughing or somebody, you know, is scared or whatever, it's like contagious throughout the entire theater. And that's one of the things that he did not, you know, a lot of guys that are watching these on DVD or whatever, they're sitting there in front of the DVD by themselves, you know, and you don't have that whole camaraderie that you have when people see things in a theater, you know?
Exactly. Actually, I told, you know, I work at a rug store right now, just kind of like, you know, pulling rugs or whatever, kind of rolling them up and taking them to people's houses and stuff like that. And
sure.
The thing with it, I was telling my boss today at work, I said, if I ever get like enough money that, you know, after I've already made my movies and I start getting some money and I get enough to actually, you know, become an owner or something, mm-hmm. the thing I'm going to invest in is a drive-in movie theater, you know, because they need to bring that back. That was the highlight. I never got a chance to have that experience, you know, because when I, you know.
You come down to Atlanta, man, we have one.
You do?
We do. I actually take the motorhome out, and it's the most fun, man. I take that thing out, and you bring your little wine and cheese, and if you want to impress a girl, take her to the drive-in, man. It's so much fun.
You should have had your premiere out there.
Well, we had talked about that, and they would have done it, but, you know, we had a digital print of the film. We didn't have it on 16 or 35, and so with that, I don't know how it would have looked. I was really kind of worried about that more than anything, but, you know, it might have just been fine because, you know,
well,
it looked great.
You could probably still do that, right, or are you not able to do that? Like, what I've understood is now they have DVD projectors,
mm-hmm.
you know, so – what they could do, like, at the theater that I like live by, that's the kind of the art house theater. We, you know, what happened was basically, you know, I was talking to them about I was actually watching. This is sad. I was watching Halloween Resurrection there, mm-hmm. and which is funny because that was the independent theater, you know.
Right.
So yeah. Like them having that on Halloween was just weird, you know. So
sure.
I'm watching there. I'm the only person in the seat, you know, in the theater, you know, watching
right.
that. And, you know, so I'm watching that, and I come over and I start talking to them. They're talking about how, you know, I said I'm trying aspiring filmmaker, and they're like, oh, yeah. And the manager's talking to me about stuff, and he says that he's about to get a DVD projector, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So if I ever, you know, if I ever get a movie on DVD, bring it over and, you know, we'll see if we could put it in there. I was like, what? Really? So they can do that now. So I'm wondering if that would be okay for a, for like a drive-in or something. That might
be
pretty cool.
It might
be.
If you guys haven't seen, I mean, Chris, have you been to a drive-in before?
Oh, yeah. It's amazing.
Yeah, it is amazing, but the screen's like absolutely huge, man. It's like it's out of a building.
And that's great. Just kind of, just hanging out. You know, just watching a movie, like just hanging out in your car, and it's awesome, man.
Do you guys have them out in Houston?
We have actually, there's I think there's one that's actually not far from where I live. Like I live in like one of the suburbs of Houston, and I was actually reading about it. It's like nearby, but I don't know. I haven't been there yet. I'll have to
right.
check it out at some point.
Well, you know, and it's so large. I mean, it's like projecting on the side of a building. I don't know. I should take it out there one day and just see, because we have a projector we could probably do it with, and that would be really interesting. I would like to actually show it out there. It'd be kind of fun, you know.
Yeah, and so. I think, like, the thing with the drive-ins, from what I've understood, I was reading, I don't know, yeah, I think it was Bruce Campbell's book, Chinska Kill.
I read that all. I've read some of it last night. I've read it several times, too.
Yeah, and the thing about it, he said he was talking about the drive-in that he lives by, mm-hmm. and that they tested, like, they watched all the drive-in movies, like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, even, like, the crappy cheerleader, you know, whatever, killers, people, you know, whatever. And the thing is, if, like, the blood that doesn't look right, people's cars would honk. And their lights would start flashing, and people would get all upset and kind of drone things out if it was just horrible, you know?
Right.
And that was, I think that would be the fun part about it. You're having fun with all the, you know, you're having fun with everybody, you know, even though they're in the car next to you. You're watching the movie, they're watching the movie, and instead of just yelling at the screen or, you know, talking on your cell phone, they're out there, you know, honking their horns and stupid, you know, scenes or whatever.
Yeah, and you're right.
That would be fun. You know, I would have loved to have that in Virginia, but no, we haven't had that, I don't think, ever. So.
Yeah. Yeah, there's definitely something about, like, watching a movie with a huge crowd, too. Actually, yeah. I tell people, like, some, like, the best two times I've probably ever had the movies were seeing Jason X and Freddy versus Jason. Because, I mean, when you see movies like that opening night, people are just totally going along with it. Like, you know, remember there was a part in Jason X where he took the girl, where Jason took the girl by the head, dipped her head in liquid nitrogen and just smashed it. And the crowd just went nuts. And it's just like, you know, I mean, that's why I go to the movies, you know, just to, you know, have moments like that. And just, you know, it's just so fun. And, you know, especially when you're with a big group of people and everybody's just totally into it. And,
well, I kind of had the exact opposite time. Like I went one time to I went to Freddy vs. Jason probably two or three times because I loved it so much in the theater.
Yeah.
You know, have you seen that, Alan?
I have not. No.
You haven't? Well, I was, you know, it's not going to spoil anything or, you know, whatever. But in the beginning of the movie, I'm watching it, and all of a sudden somebody's like talking on their cell phone. Like, they don't even care. I don't even know why they were in. They probably snuck in. You know, because they were like 15 years old.
There's definitely, you know, bad times at the theater. Actually, the absolute worst time I've ever had at the theater was back when they re-released The Exorcist. That was, like, probably, you know, when they did, like, the recut version, and they re-released it in the theaters. And The Exorcist is, like, one of my favorite movies. I love it, you know, just beginning to end. It's just brilliant and intense. There's all kinds of good stuff. And it's, like, got to be, like, you know, the last 10 minutes of the film where it's just, like, super heavy, all this crazy shit's going on, and I was just, like, glued to it. I was just really into it. Right then, a big group of, like, little kids come running in. It was so completely random. It's just, like, a bunch of little kids came in just screaming and yelling and laughing, totally unsupervised, and just like, you know, what the fuck? How did this happen?
Yeah,
you know, that I had this, not just like one of the last times I actually went to the movie, there's this guy sitting in front of me, and he's sitting in front of me about a couple of seats over. I'm sitting there watching the movie, and his watch is beeping, and it's just beep, 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 and it is driving me mad, dude. And it was just driving me mad. I was like, man, do I say something to this guy? This guy was huge, you know, and I'm like, do I say something to this guy? I mean, is he going to, like, freak out on me, or what's going to happen? I don't know. What, you know, you hear all kinds of crazy stuff. We had a guy get shot here in a movie theater not too long ago. And, I mean, you just don't know, you know? And I was like, man, I can't stand this, you know? I paid to watch this movie, too, you know? And I went over to the guy, and I said, hey, you know, your watch, do you realize it's beeping? And he goes, yeah, I know it's beeping. And I said, well, is it bothering you? And I said, yeah, it's bothering me. And he goes, oh, okay, I'll stop it. So he was real cool about it. But, yeah, you just get that kind of random kind of stuff.
Oh, you would love this then. My sister and I went to see, I guess back in the day, it was Last of the Mohicans when that first came out, like a long time ago. And it was one of the first times I went to Richmond, Virginia with my my sister. And, you know, she was living up there or whatever, and she decided to take me out for my birthday or whatever. And we went to see Last of the Mohicans. And so we're sitting there, like, kind of watching the movie. All of a sudden, the two guys in front of us are talking. and my sister literally kicks one of them in the back, like with the, you know, chair, back of the chair, and they just shut up right after that. I was like, nice, you know.
If you're a guy, you can't do anything when a girl kicks you. You just have to take it.
Absolutely.
Like, I bet they looked back and then were like, can't do anything. Sorry.
Exactly.
So it was, you know, it was funny.
I need to find your sister. Me and her go out to the movie.
Yeah.
Great.
But yeah, no. Well, no, you don't want her because after that, she started bawling at the end of the movie. At first I was all excited that she was my sister, and then after a little while I was moving down to the end of the seats because I can't take, you know, it wasn't even sad to me. I was like, it's called The Last of the Mohicans. They're all going to die.
Right, you know, yeah, right? You kind of know what's going in.
You
right?
know what's going to happen. Don't start crying because, you know, they're dying or whatever. You know, it's not that sad, you know?
Right.
I mean, I don't think Daniel Day-Lewis did that great of a job where, you know, I'm like, oh, this is so sad, you know. God, so, you know, whatever. It was funny, but, you know, I mean, she was good in that part, you know. Maybe I should have just used her for that part and then just said, oh, you can go now, and I'll just continue watching. But, no, she, you know, I don't think I've ever really gone to too many movies with her after that, so. I actually went to see Nurse Betty with her after that, like, years later, but... You know, she didn't start bawling in that movie.
Yeah.
Have you guys seen that yet? Ever? Like Nurse Betty?
Nurse Betty, which that's Renee Zellweger and Greg Kinnear, right?
Yeah.
No,
did you guys see that?
I don't think it did.
Oh, it's horrible. Don't ever.
Yeah.
No, just avoid it. You'll look at it and you... What?
Yeah, it didn't really, I think altogether, from top to bottom, nothing about it really appealed to me.
Yeah, it was pretty bad. It was pretty bad. It was like a soap opera. A girl fixated with soap operas thinks her, you know, whatever. It was bad. It was just horrible. Not good. So I went to see that for one of my birthday presents, thinking, oh, yeah, you know, it sounds funny. No.
Yeah.
Horrible. And Renee Zellweger is a good actress, though.
Yeah.
You should have her in the sequel of Motorhome Massacre.
You know, it wouldn't be a bad idea. And I think we'd do pretty well with her in it. You know, I think that's her kind of film.
Really, you think so?
She was actually in one of the Chainsaw Massacre sequels, right?
I believe so. I think
Next
she was
Generation.
In. Yeah.
Her and McConaughey were both in that movie.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
You know, this is the crazy thing, man. A lot of people get started in this genre, you know, and that's the way they kind of move up. And I mean, we were, you know, this whole big thing. There's I don't know. Anyway, there's a big thing here in Atlanta. People are, you know, trying to get things rolling and stuff. And, you know, the thing is that you've got to start producing marketable films. And the thing is that, you know, a lot of people get started, excuse me, doing, low-budget horror films because that is where you kind of are in training, you know, for your other films or whatever. And those films get out there, you know, and those are the films you actually have a chance to start building your career from, as opposed to doing a lot of these little shorts and stuff. And that's one of the things that really kind of, you know, for me, is to look at these guys that are producing the shorts. It's tough for me to watch them because the thing is, not just watch the shorts, but watch these guys spend so much time and effort on producing something that's 20 minutes, 30 minutes, 15, 10, whatever it is, long, knowing it's not commercially viable, you know, because they're not ever gonna see the other side of filmmaking. And the other side of filmmaking, like, you know, making the film, as hard as that is, there is a whole other side of actually getting it out there and getting it distributed. And if you make a short, you never have a chance of that. Never have a chance of, you know, having these guys stick you. And, you know, as far as making money and stuff like that goes, you never know how that kind of stuff works. So you learn about half of it, and then you won't learn the other half until way later if they ever make another film. And that's one of the things I think I try to mention to everybody that wants to do a film. Is forget about doing a short. Go ahead and make a feature, even if it's the crappiest thing on the planet. At least
you'll definitely learn. It's a learning experience.
Yeah, well, you've got something that's actually marketable.
I was talking to, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Dorm Days. And it's National Lampoon Presents Storm Days.
Okay, all right.
But anyway, I was talking to the writers of that, or one of the writers, Worm Miller. And
okay.
He is an incredible guy. You know, he's really nice to his fans, you know, and he made a horror film. He's made, like, a bunch of features. He made, like, 6 features.
Wow.
But, you know, but these were all, like, digital video things. And the one that got famous is called Hey, Stop Stabbing Me.
Okay.
And it's a funny, you know, comedy.
Oh.
Very goofy, you know, but it's also got horror in it, you know.
Sure, right.
So, it's, you know, but anyway, I talked to him, and I was like, you know, talked to him, do you have any advice, blah, blah, blah. And he said, well, my best advice is don't make a short. Make
yes.
a feature film. You'll learn from it. You'll move. You'll make a crappy feature. You'll move
yep.
on. You'll make another crappy feature. You'll move on. And then eventually you'll make something good.
That's the way it works, man. I mean, that's totally the way it works. And I'm sorry, Chris. I didn't mean to interrupt you there.
Oh, that's cool.
That's the way it totally works. I mean, it's better to make a crappy feature than it is to make a great short, because a great short might get you into film festivals and stuff, but all that is money out of your pocket. Going to these film festivals, there's one in every city, and it's great, you know, to win the, you know, the Des Moines, Iowa Film Festival or whatever, but the thing is, it's not going to help you. When in the long run, what people want to see that are funding these movies is that you have experience making a feature-length film and getting it out there and getting it distributed. And, you know, it's such a farce to produce these shorts because they're just not vehicles for making money, and therefore you're not viable, marketable. And, you know, that's the one thing. The guy was totally right, man. Make a crappy feature. At least you have a small chance in hell of getting – if it's crappy, you have a chance in getting it out there, you know. And if it's – like you were mentioning a minute ago, Jonathan, if it's a crappy horror feature, you might even be able to get it distributed in Blockbuster, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, horror is very, very marketable.
Yes.
You know, and it's always been.
Yeah, definitely.
Always been the thing that – because, you know, I started wanting to make movies because of movies like Ghostbusters
mm-hmm.
or whatever. Those, you know, Princess Bride. Those were my favorite movies growing up.
Right.
But later on, I started learning about horror, you know, because I've always been fascinated with horror because it's, you know, it scared the shit out of me, you know. Like,
sure.
Eli Roth, the director of Cabin Fever, has talked about in his commentary about the knowledge I have about all these other people is kind of funny, but, you know, Eli talked about, how when he was, a kid growing up, he couldn't watch horror movies.
Really?
And, because they didn't scare him. They, you know, he was all excited to watch them. He actually got physically sick and would throw up, you know, while watching the movies, you know?
Interesting.
So
okay.
His parents would be like, no, no, you can't go see that.
Right.
You know, those movies. And they banned him from doing the one thing he really liked to do until
right.
he watched Raiders of the Lost Ark when he was a kid. And he watched that in the theater, and, you know, his family was like, you can't go see that. You know, there's a person who gets his head melted. You know, it's going to scare
right.
the crap out of you. And he said, no, I'm going to try it. You know, he went to see it, and he didn't get sick. And then after
okay.
that, he could actually watch horror movies.
Nice.
You know? And then he ended up, you know, working for Troma for a little bit. And then after his work on Troma, he saved up some money and he made Cabin Fever. So, mm-hmm. I mean, and now he's one of the, you know, richest new guys, you know, in the world of, you know, independent horror.
Yeah,
you know?
He's hot right now. He's on fire, man. And you know,
yeah,
the thing is, he's done a great job marketing himself for sure, because everybody knows who he is in this industry, that's for sure. But I had a point there, and I forgot what it was. But I think the main thing is that you've got to keep on making films, like he, you know, like he said, is like you work with Troma or you work with anybody else, but you keep on making those films until. You know, you get something that is decent out there, and you get something that people do like, you know. And oh, I know what it was. The horror films. The cool thing about the horror films, once I started getting into this, I hadn't even really thought about it before I started writing Motorhome. But it's the wide latitude that you have in horror films is that you can make a a love story in there. You can put some comedy in there. You can put some drama in there. You can put some action adventure. The whole thing. And I do think they're almost like the vaudeville of cinema. You can put all this different stuff in there, and that's why people like it, because of the variety. Because you never know exactly what you're going to get, you know?
Exactly. And
that's,
I think
that's definitely a thing with that's so true with horror too. It's like you can kind of put anything into it. It's like I always find that in horror movies, like if you mix it with comedy, it's just like they kind of amplify each other, and you just kind of get. Kind of a really cool effect from it, I think. To me, it's like I laugh really hard at, the funny stuff in Hostel and Cabin Fever. To me, it's just all the more funnier because it's in a horror movie to me.
Oh, absolutely, man. You look at, Sam Raimi, he did Evil Dead. And I don't know that he intended that movie to be that funny, to be honest with you. And I think, because, the first one, Bruce Campbell wasn't doing his groovy thing and all that other stuff. He was not the character he became in Evil Dead, the second and the third one. Those things kind of evolved. But I think what they did was see how people took it. And they saw that it was campy, and they laughed about it and stuff. And they saw how ridiculous it was, and they just buckets of blood dropping on people and stuff. And I think he did the right thing and took it to the direction he did that series, and built his name on that. And I think it made everybody be okay with laughing at stuff, at a horror film. So, and I do think that's one of the cool things about horror is that you can just put so many things in it, and it's still considered a horror film. It's still a drama, and it's not dramatic, man. You've really got a problem on your hands. Or if you put together a comedy, and it's not funny from beginning to end, you've got a problem on your hands. You've got to fix it some way, and it's really hard to do. Horror, you can be comedic in one part and be, downright horrific in another, and it's perfectly okay. It's acceptable, and I think that's the coolest thing about them.
The one thing I wanted to mention about that, about you saying about Evil Dead, I guess, what I heard from Josh Becker when he came on the show, and he was talking about his relationship with Bruce and growing up with Sam Raimi and everything. He was there for Evil Dead. He actually, worked on Evil Dead, the first one, and he's been doing stuff for Evil Dead 2 and Army of Darkness. And the funny thing is, he was there during the first interview that Sam had. And what happened was, he intended it for it to be a straight horror movie, no comedy, no comedy whatsoever.
The first one,
it's definitely a little more straighter than
everybody kept coming out of the theater laughing their ass off at it, at the end and whatnot. And so all of a sudden some interviewers asking Sam, what did you think about this movie? Were you trying to make it a horror, blah blah blah? And he said, he said, "Oh yeah, we intended it to be a horror comedy." And that was not their intention.
Of course you say that, man. What else would you say?
You screwed up somewhere along the line and got everybody to laugh. So he hired Scott Spiegel to co-write Evil Dead 2, because Scott Spiegel was also the funny one too, and could kind of be the yin to his yang, I guess. Help him spruce it up. But Evil Dead 2. Yeah, a lot of people have said that. I get this a lot when I ask people about Evil Dead. Have you seen Evil Dead? And everybody thinks that. A lot of people think Army of Darkness is their favorite. And Evil Dead 1 is really, truly the best.
I think. It's got some really interesting parts in it. No doubt about that. And that whole, that tree raping the girl. It's just, crazy, So it's got some interesting parts to it. I think Bruce Campbell and all those guys, reading their, reading that book, Chins Could Kill. You get a sense. The whole first half of that book is really talking about Evil Dead, about how they got it going and how they all launched their careers with that, and how it's that is a testimony of what it takes to get things done, because they struggled for years. Even after they did that film, it took them over 6 years to pay back their investors that they had on the film. 6 years.
Yeah.
And that was one of the most successful horror films of all time, you know? So,
yep.
I mean, it probably still is. No.
Yeah,
I mean, I think that, you know, and it's now like the basis for everybody's, you know, like every movie, every horror movie these days, a lot of people compare things to Evil Dead. Yeah.
You know, right, yeah.
Because it paved the way. Like, I mean, they even say in Bruce even says in F. Chinska Kill that, you know, that they looked at movies like Halloween, and they researched movies like that, and they've researched movies like Texas Chainsaw Massacre to see what worked and what didn't, because those were, like, the ones that were, like, hot at the time. And, I mean, those are classics. So.
And that's a good thing to bring up, too, is, like, how, you know, they did market research on that. Before they ever started doing that film, they went out and they saw what was actually made and what was making money. And that's important, I think, to think about. And because, you know, the rules have been set. You know, in Hollywood, the guys they're interested in buying certain kinds of movies and that type of thing. You know, and you have to kind of set and play by their rules, because these are the things they're going to buy out in Hollywood. These are the things they're going to actually put out there on the market for people. And I think a lot of independent guys, a lot of indie guys, they go out and they put together their, you know, dramatic movie or whatever that they feel is so close to their heart and they really need to put out there, which I'm perfectly okay with that, but it still has to be a certain marketability to it, you know?
Exactly.
And you put out these indie films that are, you know, they try to be a black comedy or this, that, the other thing, and it just, man, it's just a tough sell. If you, unless you have like a named actor in it, it's really hard. But if you put together a little horror film and you put some sex in there and some horror and all that stuff, and it's just a lot easier road to take and to launch your career, you know?
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, you know, people do like, you know, and a lot of people nowadays are doing short films that, you know, are shot on actual film to get into like festivals and stuff, but to me, I think that's like a waste of time and money, because unless you're somebody like I know Danica McKellar, who played Winnie Cooper on Wonder Years, she's done a bunch of short films that she has taken to festivals. Now she has a name,
right?
People know, you know, people, even if they don't know her name, they'll say, you know, Danica McKellar, you know, parentheses, you know, Winnie Cooper from Wonder Years, and everybody's like, ah, you know?
Right, right.
So they know who she is. She's famous enough where she can use the, you know, use that to her advantage. Now, somebody else, you know, Billy Bob from, you know, Arkansas tries to do that, you know, and if it's not, if it doesn't show enough of talent, you know, or whatever, it's just not going to be looked at, you know?
Yeah. I would say, you know, to anybody that tries to go down that road, one of the things I would say, hey, you know, name three short films that you really liked.
Yeah.
And most people can't do it. You can't come up with one name.
Yeah, I'll name one that I really, really like.
Yeah,
it's kind of George Lucas
like
and Love.
Films, you know?
Have you guys seen that?
Wasn't that feature length, though?
No.
Oh, was it?
George Lucas and Love? No.
I've never actually seen it, so I don't know.
Have you seen that, Alan?
I have not, no.
Oh, man, it's fantastic. In fact, I'm trying to get the director of Evil Hill, which was also another great parody, which was Notting Hill with Dr. Evil in it.
Okay.
But, no, these are parodies. George Lucas in Love is basically Star Wars with a touch of, you know, well, it's about George Lucas coming up with his muse for the Star Wars movies, but using it as Shakespeare in Love. So he's walking around campus, you know, at USC. And it's, oh, my God, it's fantastic. If you guys, like, see it at the store or something and whatnot, it's only, like, $10 or something, probably even less. But it's fantastic. It's got a bunch of short films on it. Evil Hill's the only other good one, you know.
Yeah.
But it's certainly, definitely...
Yeah.
Like, it's the best of the, you know, of the parodies, you know?
Yeah. In regards to like shorts, I mean, there's definitely really only so much you can do with a short. I mean, they're good for like maybe putting on, you know, YouTube and stuff, but it's like, you know, a feature is really what's going to, you know, sell.
Yeah, that's what's going to sell. That's what's marketable right now. And that, I mean, that's what you can sell. You know, and you're right about the YouTube thing is great. You can put, I mean, heck, you can put a feature on YouTube, I suppose, but the thing that's going to, you know, actually sell, and the thing that people, that the guys want, and the things that they understand how to market are the feature films. That's something that Hollywood understands. They've been doing that for 100 years now, you know, so they understand it. And that's, so you kind of have to play by their rules, and if independent guys would do that more often, and I'll be honest with you, I think they are. I think a lot of more independent guys are seeing that, you know, you have to kind of fall in line with what's already out there in order to start your career and not necessarily try to reinvent the wheel, you know, when you come out of it, you know. A lot of guys, especially here in Atlanta, I mean, for a while there, people would take me out to lunch every day and ask me, how did you get distribution? How did you get it on the Lionsgate? And, you know, I mean, just every, and they'd say, I got this film, I've been trying for a year to get it out there, and nobody will look at it. And I said, well, what's it about? Well, it's about these seven kids that are real depressed, and they get this one guy that kills himself, and then that's probably pretty much it, and they're all artists. And I'll go, okay, we got any sex in it? Yeah, not really. Do you have anybody that takes their clothes off in it? No, nobody does that. And okay, so you have a dramatic piece. Do you have any named actors in it? Well, no, but we really like it. We think it's going to get out there. We just need to find the right guy to, you know, get out there and market it for us. And I'm like,
Wait a minute. Is it already finished, or is it just a script?
No, this thing's finished.
This thing's finished?
Yeah.
And so it's just a bunch of kids just hanging around being artsy?
I swear to God to you. And
wow.
It's it's all based on this one guy killing himself in the group. And it's very depressing. Okay.
I mean that could work if it's told well. I mean, just the question I would ask, if I were sitting down in that conversation is this a story you've really wanted to tell? I mean, is this something that you think people would be interested in? Because, like, I mean, to me, it's, the only movies that I like are things that interest me, you know?
Right,
I mean,
right, yeah, sure.
Like, and that's what I've wanted to do. I mean, every time I think of a script these days or try to write up a script, I'm trying to think of something that would please me but not also, and also be, like, in a way original, because really nothing's going to be completely original these days.
Right.
There's always something that's copying off of something that's happened, you know, in some movie or something. You know what I mean?
Totally, man. You're absolutely right. Yeah, I mean, everything is, there's only like, you know, four or five real original stories, and it's the way you retell them. But I do think that, you know, you've got to look at your story, and you got to look at what you're doing before you ever put it down and, you know, on paper or shoot it. And then you think, you know, a lot of the guys, that's the way a lot of the filmmakers, that's what happens to them. They fall in that trap to where they want to produce something. They've got this idea that they want to see, but they don't necessarily think about, like, the bigger market, think about who else would want to see this besides just me, you know? And it's pretty easy to get, I mean, people involved in a project. You go out and you have a casting call, and then, like you said, you raise a couple $1,000 and you shoot one of these things. And then later on, you start thinking about distribution. And when you should have started thinking about distribution was when you're writing it and who you're trying to reach, what's your market, mm-hmm. and make sure that you're going along those lines for a first timer. You know, you're following those Hollywood rules, so you don't necessarily make something that is so far out there, there's no way you can get it distributed. You know?
Exactly. But, I mean, you want to look at, like, things that have already been done before and try to one-up it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'm working on a script that I'm doing in July. It's a movie, you know, basically for my friend Meg, who would usually be the host of the show, but is out because she got her tonsils taken out. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so, but she's, well, you know, basically my actress, you know,
mm-hmm.
and she's going to be the main star of this, hopefully, in July, and it's basically about this girl, and the original story was this girl goes to audition, she goes psycho somehow, you know, trying to get a part of a Scream Queen, and starts killing everybody at the audition just to get the part.
Cool.
And well, it sounds cool, and so I looked at it, and I go, wait, aren't there other movies just like this in a way? Like, how can I make this a little bit different?
Right.
So it's like, well, how about we have another person actually play the original killer and then have her be possessed by a demon?
Okay.
Right? So then there's a showdown between these two killers who are
yep.
killing people off. Each one's killing somebody off, you know? Mm. And now they're like, whoa, who's going to be the top dog now, you know?
Yes. Right. Exactly.
And I was like, nobody's ever done that. Nobody's taken it to that level of absurdity, you know?
Yeah.
So I was like, you know, I can one-up it a little bit and kind of win on some kind of originality. And then I can also use the makeup effects that a friend of mine I met online, Ricky Lee, who does awesome effects. You know, he's done some incredible. He's, like, graduated from the Tom Savini School of makeup.
Oh, nice. Sure.
Yeah, so he's incredible. And so he was like, yeah, if you just pay for my, you know, my stuff for it and, you know, pay for me to come up there from Florida, I was like, yeah, sure. So he's incredible. So I asked him, you know, I told him about the idea, and everybody's liked the idea, but now, you know, it's the idea of making it look cool, you know.
Right.
And look good, you know. Right.
Yeah. Well, it's important. Yeah, I think it's important to have a good story, and that's probably, I think you know, if you can have a good story, I think that's probably the most important thing, and one that has a beginning, a middle, and an end, you know, and try to work off of that, and try, and then the effects and stuff. I think are important. I do think they're very important, but I think also that you can get away with a minimal amount of effects if you have, like you were talking about earlier, have a good story. You know,
yeah.
It doesn't have to be the most, you know, the most traumatic, the most head blowing off, and I think you can go a little overboard with that too if you're not careful, because there is a point where you get into that where it's just so schlocky with all that stuff that it has to go to another level of distributor, you know, because some people just won't pick it up, you know. But yeah, I do think the effects are important, but I do think you need to, if you can concentrate on the story. And I would really try to do that more with my new movie, Evil Keg, than I did with Motorhome. I try to concentrate on the Motorhome Massacre movie for sure, but I realized afterward, like, okay, I really need to concentrate on the story and make sure this is a good, solid piece. And that's what I really try to do, even more so with Evil Keg. And I think we got a lot better story in this one, so who knows.
You gotta have a story. It's like, you know, I mean, take a movie like you know, like Spider-Man, like the first Spider-Man,
right?
You know, it's just like, you know, I mean, some of the effects look kind of tacky and cheesy, but it's like, I don't care, because I love Spider-Man.
Yeah.
And I love the story, and I love how they told it.
Yeah.
And
I think Sam Raimi, in fact, I think you can tell that he loves, you know, the character of Spider-Man.
Yeah, definitely.
And it comes through in the movies, you know?
Yeah, Sam Raimi and Spider-Man, I thought, were just such a perfect match.
Yeah.
I mean, you can tell from the movie, even, you know, kind of, you know, getting back to, like, the Evil Dead a little bit, it's like, you can tell, I mean, it's like, you can see a lot of, like, the stuff that he did in previous movies and, you know, the Spider-Man movies. Like, a lot of the horror movie aspects. Like, in, you know, like, you know, part two with, like, the part where, you know, Dr. Octopus in the hospital room and stuff. And it's like, you see elements of, you know, Evil Dead.
Right.
And
right,
it's like,
right.
He's kind of utilizing the tools that he had going on in, you know, like Evil Dead.
Yeah, it was dark and, you know, I mean, it was definitely not the Spider-Man you've actually read in the Marvel comics. It was,
yeah,
you know, taking it, and that's going back to what we were talking about on your show, Chris, Transformers.
Yeah.
I mean, have you seen the, Alan, have you seen the Transformers?
I haven't. I heard about it.
Trailer. Yeah, everybody's been talking about it because it's incredibly crazy. It's,
right.
You know, like I was telling Chris, I showed it to my dad, But I didn't tell him it was Transformers first. I said, just check this trailer out. So he starts watching it. I was like, oh, it looks like, you know, to him, I guess it looked like a big blockbuster movie, right?
Right.
You know, sci-fi movie. All of a sudden, he's like, well, you know, this looks like Transformers. You know, but he didn't even think anything of it. I think he thought it might be something else.
Yeah.
So we watch it, and all of a sudden it says Transformers, you know, and he's like, that's crazy. That's awesome. You know?
Yep.
So it was definitely, you know, he said he would never watch it, but you know, I think that's just because he's my dad. He doesn't want to watch, you know, a kid, you know, what was originally a kid's cartoon show, but you know.
Right. Well, you know, I think if the story is good, I think you can really get it out. It's a lot easier to make. Like, if you've already got a good story and you can add on these bits and pieces, like some of the other elements, some of the head chopping off and the running over or whatever else you got in there, and add the effects in there. Those are just icing on the cake. If you've got a nice story already.
Really, really, you can't make a horror movie without some kind of gore these days.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if I agree with that. I think you can. I mean, if you look at, going back to Alfred Hitchcock, and he's more of a psychological thriller kind of thing, but, I mean, like, Alfred Hitchcock was Psycho. I mean, the only thing you saw in that film was the
blood going down the drain.
And that was chocolate syrup.
Yeah, because they, actually, I forgot where I heard that you can do that, but the idea being, you know, when you do if you film it in black and white, you can get away with not using caro syrup and stuff because, you know, you could just use what you said, like, was it syrup or something?
Chocolate syrup is what they, from what I, that's what I heard in Psycho, because it's just the way it oozes, you know, it has that consistency to it. But that's the thing. It's like you look at something like that, that's one of the scariest movies of all time. You know, I mean, it's the top of the top. And but those are the things that if you're smart about how you do it, you know, and I don't know that you necessarily have to have the gore.
I'll disagree with you on one thing. Like, it's a classic. Now, I will say that. And I love Alfred Hitchcock. But the thing I don't like about Psycho is it just didn't give me – like Norman Bates didn't do anything with me because he just kind of he didn't even seem like creepy. He just seemed very boring, you know. And then he kills Jamie Lee Curtis's mother,
right?
Or Janet Leigh, I believe, in that scene.
By today's standard, it's so much different, man. So much different by today's standard. You're totally right. I mean, it wasn't that animated, but I. But, you know, for the time, it was just like, that was creepy, you know? So, he has a different little flair in there that today has seemed way more accepted. It's hard for me to say. But,
I think that's going to be the problem with people looking back to the classics is today, you know, today's standards are mainly about the special effects. So somebody will look at something like Psycho, and they will totally dismiss it and say, you know, well, that wasn't that good. And the day when everybody around me says that because they're all, you know, 10 years younger than me, you know?
Right, right.
I'm going to eat my socks because everybody is going to be doing that, and it's going to just make me go crazy.
Sure.
And, yeah, I mean, you know, it's what's going to happen because all right, I'll say this. My friend Rick, Rick Fusselman, does a show on this blog talk radio thing called Crypt Radio. He, you know, he interviews people occasionally, but he does mainly like reviews of horror movies. Mm-hmm. And he was talking about, him and his. I called in to say hello, and kind of the guy that was with him was like 16 years old, and he's almost like the other guy. You know, Rick's almost like 26. You know,
right.
So, but they both liked, you know, they both asked me if I played World of Warcraft. Now, no, I don't play video games.
Right.
I just don't. I've got too much time watching freaking movies. I don't have enough time to play, like, you know, endless. I don't want to die like that guy who played World of Warcraft.
Okay.
Have you heard about that?
No, I have not.
You got, Chris, have you heard of it?
I haven't heard of that. Well, like, what happened?
They made fun of it in South Park. But what happened was this guy played World of Warcraft. From what I've heard, you know, I don't know if this is just a rumor, but you know, this guy played World of Warcraft until he, you know, he didn't eat, he didn't sleep, he didn't do anything. He just played it for like 7 days straight and died.
Wow.
I mean, you know, he died of starvation, and he died of all this other stuff. I mean, you would think that once your stomach starts rumbling, it's time to go get food, pause the game.
Yeah, it's like, you know, pause the game, get a Hot Pocket, then go back to the game, you know.
I know. And, if, you know, you can, I mean, even if you sleep, it's not like the game's all, where the power could go out. Ooh, my God. That's why video games are made today, so you can save where you're at, you know. I mean, it's just ridiculous that, I mean,
I'll be honest with you, the video game thing, I mean, I have played before, but I'll be honest with you, I get bored of them pretty quick. I mean, it's just like...
Not the same way, yeah.
Yeah, either, I mean, they're actually, even how complicated they are today, they're still repetitive. I mean, you get to a certain level and you're like, okay, this is, I'm going to have to just do this faster, or I'm going to have to do this a different way or whatever, but... They're very repetitive, and that just kind of bores me after a while. And it's just like, okay, yes, it's a challenge. The only games I do like are the ones where you're playing against like another person. I do like those. Those are kind of challenging because then you don't know what what's going to happen. But anyway,
I like Pong. I mean, Pac-Man, Pitfall. Pitfall is one of my favorites. I mean, the Atari games. You know, I mean, I used to even have the Ghostbusters game for Atari, which was the most...
I remember that game.
Oh, it was the most ridiculous game I've ever played.
Yeah, it was like the trap was like basically the Ghostbusters logo, like the
I never even got there. Right. I never got to use anything. I couldn't even get out of the street.
Yeah.
The ghost would attack me on the street. It was ridiculous.
Yeah, it was pretty terrible.
But, no, I mean, like, you know, I used to have that, and then we got rid of our Atari. We gave it to, like, the Goodwill, you know. And I ended up stealing my brother's Nintendo.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, and that's been what I still have it. Well, I think I bought a new Nintendo, but I still have all my games and stuff. So, you know, I play that all the time, you know.
Yeah.
And that's my thing, you know. I mean... I'd rather play the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles arcade game.
Yeah.
You know. Have you guys played that? Like, the arcade game version of Ninja Turtles?
Actually, yeah. I do remember playing that, like, when I was younger.
How about you, Alan? Have you ever played those games?
I don't remember that one, but, I mean... I don't actually remember that one. But, the arcade games, when I was a kid, I used to go in there and play them. I mean, it's like... My mom would give me like $2, and now I mean that's 8 games, and so you ended up having to either you basically walk around and watch the other kids play the games, and you figured out all the tricks. And so when you actually use your quarter, you get the free guy all the time, you know.
Oh, that's like the Wizard. You guys ever seen that movie?
Yeah, I remember. Yeah, that's with
Fred Savage.
Yeah, Fred Savage. Yeah, Fred and Ben Savage, wasn't it? Yeah.
And Christian Slater.
Oh,
yeah. Beau Bridges.
Cool. Wow.
Huge stars in this funny, goofy movie, which became a big Nintendo commercial.
Wow.
I mean, there was one scene where the guy's using the power glove, which I bought, and it sucked. It was the worst, the worst tool ever. Like, I had the power pad, which rocked. And then I had the, you know, the power glove was just so ridiculous. I mean, it was like, you know, you're playing with the power glove, but I couldn't figure out how to actually use the controls, like the buttons, because there were like codes you had to press them for different games or whatever. But I just couldn't figure it out. And then all of a sudden things were just like malfunction on, you know, but you know, in The Wizard it looked like it actually worked. You know?
Yep.
And the guy looks over after playing with the, you know, power glove, and he looks over and goes, you know, I guess the power glove, it's so bad. And I was like, oh, my God, they're about to go power glove from Nintendo.
Right.
I mean, it was just a big commercial.
Sure.
And so I was like, you know, that's pretty cool. I mean, it was good. You know, it was like, you know, when I'm 10 years old watching that, I'm not thinking, oh, this is a commercial. I'm thinking, oh, this is pretty cool. I got to go get the Power Glove.
Right.
I did.
Yeah.
Because of that movie. Worst investment in my life.
Oh, that's the worst investment you made. You're doing okay, man.
Okay.
Yeah.
The worst investment until I do my movie and then it fails.
Yeah.
Hopefully, I don't know if you've been listening to any of the other shows, Alan.
I have not had an opportunity, Jonathan. I apologize, but
that's totally fine. That's totally fine. I don't blame you. They mainly, some of them go like 2 hours long, which is what the show might go up to. But you know, it was just, you know, it works because people like all of a sudden forget, you know, about the time because you know, they're having a fun time. And so we were doing one with Megan Berwick yesterday, who was in a TV show called Salute Your Shorts.
Okay.
I don't know if you ever saw that at all or heard of it.
I did not. Nope.
No? You never heard of it?
What's it called?
Salute Your Shorts.
Salute Your Shorts. I have not.
Yeah, I was on Nickelodeon like back in...
91?
91, yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
No, I have not heard of it. So you guys will have to educate me.
Well, it's basically a camp show. It's about these kids in camp. Like they were like 11 or so, you know.
Yep.
And they, you know, I mean, it was basically camp. I don't know how else to describe it. They go stories. They play capture the flag.
Yeah, it's basically just like, you know, just like, you know, kind of kids hanging out, being kids in summer camp, like camp adventures. And yeah.
And they had the camp theme song, you know, and stuff like that they sang in the beginning for their regular theme song. And
okay.
It was a cute little show. And I had the girl that played ZZ on there last night. Chris, me, and a couple of my other friends, Richard and Justin, came on and started talking about, you know, just different things about Salute Your Shorts because they're all fans. So they all love to talk about different stuff on that, you know, topic. And I asked Megan if she wanted to, by any chance, act in my movie. You know, we fly her from L.A., you know.
Sure.
And she said, sure. Well, kind of, I guess. I mean, it didn't seem like I was forcing her into it, but Chris, you would say she.
I think she gave an affirmative to the movie.
Yeah.
Like if it, you know, if it ends up happening and stuff.
Like, so hopefully,
I mean,
yeah.
I mean, when it ends up happening. I mean.
Yeah. And that's going to be late July.
Well, you know, I think there's a lot of these guys, these actors that that was certainly they all want to work, you know, and they whatever part they're always interested. And Tom Savini was almost in Motorhome. I mean, actually, we talked to him about it, and we're going to have him play one of the parts, the park ranger in it. And the part became a lot bigger than what I anticipated, and so we could not afford him for the whole entire time. We could only afford him for like the day, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, but you know, I was kind of waiting, and I was like, okay, do we really need Tom Savini in this, or do we not? You know, and
right.
The other day I said, no, I don't think we do. Let's save that money.
Wait,
spend it toward
how much
catering.
Was he charging something at that time, or?
Oh yeah, they'll all charge something. It depends on whatever you know you kind of work out with them. But I mean, these guys are between you know $1,000 to $10,000 a day, you know, something like that. Then plus you got to fly them down and pay for the hotel and that type of thing. So.
Well, I had an interview with Chris Watson, who did a movie called Zombiegeddon.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if you've heard of it or whatever, but
I haven't.
It's actually distributed through Troma.
Okay, cool.
And he had Tom Savini's movie, and I was talking to him about that. And I talked to him about that. I don't know if I talked to him on my show about it or if I talked to him on the cell phone about it or whatever. But his thing about it was you know, it was all just kind of random. Like, he had been going to this convention that Tom was supposed to be at.
Right.
And then he saw Tom, and he asked Tom if he wanted to do a scene in the movie and, like, in his hotel room. And
okay.
Actually, it turns out to be Brink Stevens' hotel room that they shot it at.
Right.
So Brink Stevens and him have a scene together, and they, you know, where he plays a guy who believes he's Jesus Christ.
Okay.
You know? So So only Chris Watson would cast Tom Savini as Jesus Christ. But it was a funny scene. I've seen the movie. It's really funny. It's great. Chris is such a good guy. You know, he's really trying to go out there and make his good versions of B movies. You know.
Sure. Right.
And yep. That's really that's all you can ask for. And Tom. Well, how he got Tom was he asked Tom to do it, and Tom was like, yeah, I'll do it. You know, and then comes around the time we were supposed to do it, they got Brink, they got the room all set up,
Right.
And no Tom. So they went and saw that he was doing a Q&A.
Okay.
So he went up to some kid and said, hey, go up to that man on the microphone and tell him he's supposed to be doing this movie right now.
Right.
So this little kid runs up and says, hey, those guys over there told me to tell you that you're supposed to be doing a movie right now.
Right.
And they start waving at Tom, and Tom's like, hey, I'm supposed to be doing this movie right now. If you all want to come up, come on up. It'll be a party.
Oh, well, that's kind of cool.
He invited everybody to come out to see the movie being done, but that actually became more of a hassle because
they
had to tell everybody to be quiet, and they were using actual microphones and stuff, and they wanted to drown out all the sound. But I thought that was I thought that was a good story.
He's available. Well, all these guys are available,
and he did it for free for that one. But
wow.
I guess he did it for free there because he was at the convention, it was the right place, right time, and he was able to do this little short scene. And he's not going to pay $1,000 for, a scene, And then later on, the PS to that story is the producer and Chris Watson walked up to, the producer's like, wouldn't it be funny if I came up with a copy of Zombiegeddon and I asked him to sign it?
Right.
And so he came up to, him, and he's like, will you sign this for me? He's like, why? And he goes, because you're in it? He's like, I am? Oh, yeah, I am. Wow, this is the worst piece of crap I ever was in. And Chris had to pull the producer away.
Oh, my God.
He was like, what? That's funny. So let me go up to Tom and ask him, to sign it still again and say, I think his name is Andrew. To Andrew, this is the worst piece of crap I was ever in. Just, as kind of a funny, thing. But because he didn't need to say it. He didn't think, he was just kind of being his obnoxious, self,
Yeah.
You know how they are.
So. Yeah, a lot of guys got egos in this this film community, I would think. But yeah, I think you can't get those guys in your film if you ask them, and if you do, like you said, if you do have the money to pay the guys to get out of there, there's a film here in Atlanta that is gonna, if it hasn't come out yet, it's gonna be out pretty soon, called Blood Car. And have you guys heard anything about this film? Yeah,
I have
Blood
not.
Car.
Blood Car.
Okay. It's got a girl, what was that movie? Her name is Anna Chlumsky.
Oh, Anna Chlumsky? Wow.
Chlumsky, yeah.
My Girl.
From My Girl, yeah. So it's got her in it, and it's a big movie. I mean, these guys are really, a lot of people like it, or at least I don't think it's come out yet, but the guys here in Atlanta have done it, and so,
how did they get her? Did they just ask, or?
I don't know, to be honest with you. I do know they asked at some point, and somehow she said yes. I'm sure they had to pay her to come out, but she's trying to get started again in film. So this is her first film that she's an adult,
Right. Oh, wow.
So,
I would love to ask her sometime. I mean, she was a childhood, icon to me. I mean.
Sure.
Like, it's weird because you say her name, and I'm like, holy crap. And you're probably like, I guess she's kind of big, But to me, she's huge.
There you go. Blood Car is the guy's name, is the film, and I'm sure those guys would be interested in talking to you guys if you would like. But the
do you know how I can get in contact with them? Like, do they have a MySpace or something? Or
yeah, they have a MySpace, and if I'll make some contacts for you and see if we can get something worked up.
Actually, Josh Becker helped me get. Have you heard of Gary Jones?
Gary Jones, who is that?
Have you ever seen? Let's see, Crocodile to Death Swamp?
I think I did see that, yep.
Yeah, he directed that movie.
Okay, cool.
But he was the special effects supervisor on, like, Crime Wave, which was Sam Raimi's first movie, and then he did, like, Thou Shalt Not Kill Except and a bunch of different movies for those guys, and he ended up doing a bunch of movies. Recently he did Raptor Island 2. Well, I'm a huge fan of his. Through watching Crocodile 2 Death Swamp, like, just, you know, that movie just, you know, it was a mind blow for me.
Right.
And great stuff. And so, I was talking about him and to Josh, since they're, like, good friends, since they worked on, like, Thou Shalt Not Kill Except and, you know, Alien Apocalypse together, I asked him, asked what he was up to, and Josh told me, and I said, it would be great, and just out of passing, I was like, it would be great to get him on the show sometime. He's like, yeah, I'll get you in contact with him.
Sure.
to me, I was like, you know, you should have saw my mouth actually literally drop, you know? Like, I don't think my mouth has ever actually do that, where I'm like, whoa, you know?
Right. Well, you know, a lot of these guys are, you know, like, it's
and they want to promote
people
stuff.
Nice people. Sure, of course. They want to promote stuff. They want to get out there. They want to chat. I mean, they're all up for that. So, yeah, if you guys want to talk to the guys with Blood Car, I'll see what I can do about getting that stuff for you guys.
That would be awesome. Cool. I mean, I'd love to hear about it. His name is Alex Orr?
It's a horror film, and it's about – you'd have to – I don't really exactly know what it's about. You'd have to let them explain it to you, but it's a
– Well, I've got the IMDb thing about here.
Okay.
In the near future, gas prices are at astronomical high. One man is determined to find an alternate fuel source. The alternate fuel source turns out to be blood, human blood. Blood car. That actually sounds really kind of funny and political in a way.
Yeah, I dig it.
Yeah, I would watch that. And especially with Anna Chlumsky being in it, it's just really funny to see her because – you know, actually, I hadn't, like, heard of her doing anything recently. So, like, I actually keep updating to try to see if IMDb says anything about her. She was, like, at one point, it said, where are they now? And she was, like, doing something, like, somewhere in New York, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And she wasn't had anything to do with the film industry, so.
She's in that one, that's for sure. I know that. The there's another film here in Atlanta that just got accepted to the Sundance Film Festival called The Signal. And it's directed by four guys here, and Jacob Gentry, I think David Boucher is the way you say his name, I think, and a couple other dudes. And but it's a horror film. So these guys are actually in Sundance this year. And these guys, I mean, Jacob has done a great job promoting himself and getting out there. His first film was a big film with Faye Dunaway in it and David Carradine. Young dude. He's like, maybe he's 27 now, maybe. He was like 25 when he did that big movie. So he's getting out there and doing stuff. And these guys have had a lot of success. So there are things that are happening here in Atlanta that are not necessarily happening in a lot of cities, but are, you know, it's amazing the talent pool that we have here, and the amount of, like, great actors and the crew and the whole thing. It's things are happening in the city. It's slow, but it is definitely happening for sure. Yeah.
And I think it's happening everywhere though. Like, more people are going out there and making movies, and you know, also that also makes it kind of difficult because, you know, this person makes a movie and it's awful. That's going to reflect on, you know, other people when they try to go out there and try to do their own movies. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, that happens. But as long as, like what we were talking earlier, I mean, as long as you're making things that are, you know, possibly marketable, and that's all that really matters. And, that, you know, there's going to be a market for stuff, you know, and there's – you know, you can't be too quick to judge on everybody's stuff because, You know, it's for something that maybe not I would care for, there's somebody out there that just loves it, you know, and it's just crazy.
Yeah.
And that's the one thing you have to kind of keep an open mind to in this industry is that, you know, that's just, it's not all about just like one person's taste, thank God, you know?
Right.
Exactly.
And you have to make it work for everybody, you know?
Yeah.
And that probably is the most difficult part, you know? And, you know, right now I want to touch up on about Evil Keg. Did you come up with the title yourself, or did you go through different titles like you did with Motorola Massacre?
Evil Keg was a lot easier. I just, ended up doing the Screen Queen casting calls for Motorhome at this brewery that's in downtown Atlanta. It's the Atlanta Brewing Company, and Greg Kelly was the owner at the time, and he invited us down there to have this, and we did a couple of events down there, like two or three different events. We did the rap party down there, a Scream Queen call, and we did a couple other things, and I just kept looking around the brewery, and I was like, man, this place is so cool, and I'd just love to be able to shoot a film here. And so I came up with a name. I was like, man, Evil Keg. How cool is that? And so once I came up with a name, then that's when I came up with the movie, the actual storyline. And that was a lot more difficult than just coming up with a name. The name's, I think, kind of catchy, but like putting together a story around an Evil Keg was a little bit hard. So,
do you think that maybe when people see that title, they might think of Evil Bong?
Well, this is the weird thing, man. I don't know which one of us came up with it first, who registered what first, but I think he might have been a little bit ahead of me, but I had no idea of Evil Bong when I came up with Evil Keg, and it's because I've been working on a script for over a year. And so, you know, Evil Bong was not around when I started, because I did a lot of research before I started, you know, writing this thing, and Evil Bong was not around, but... Hey, you know, I'm glad they're around. I haven't seen the movie yet. Have you guys seen it?
No, don't. Like,
okay.
We've been talking about it. Like, well, I mean, it's Charles Band, and I'd love to have him on the show, but you know, I wouldn't diss the movie. I mean, it was what it was, you know. And the only problem with Evil Bong is that they don't really, like, it's only like two interiors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and no exteriors throughout the whole movie. And that's kind of, you know, when you do a horror movie, you don't want to do that. I mean, it might seem like the safe route because there's no weather problems or anything.
Right.
But when you do a movie like that, you don't want to, you know, you want to kind of, I don't know, you kind of want to do something a little bit crazier. And, you know, it seemed like you have much more of a budget than what, you know what I mean?
Right.
And they did. I mean, it's full moon. You know, so I'm wondering why Charles Band didn't, you know, I guess he that's what happens when you do it. You know, he wrote in 6 weeks, he wrote it in like a couple of days and then, you know, did pre-production for 6 weeks. And then he did the movie. And it shows, you know.
Yeah, you can force things out too fast. I mean, that is for sure. And I haven't seen it. I hate to make any comment on the guy's stuff, but I do know that, you know, we were not in co-writing anything together or anything. It's just kind of weird how it came out, but that's whatever. You know, that's the way it works sometimes. But his movie will be, you know, right there with mine, I suppose, if I get that far with it. You know, knock on wood. Hopefully we will. So.
I mean, is it harder now that your movie was distributed by Lionsgate to and get something else out?
Harder. What do you mean by that, Jonathan? Like,
well,
how do you mean?
I mean, like, okay, so you've got, you know, you got the movie distributed. Were anybody, you know, were you trying to pitch Evil Keg to anybody else or anything, or?
I have not, and I did pitch the script to one person that I had already talked to out in Hollywood. And they're interested. They want to see the finished movie, and that's what a lot of people do. They want to see the finished movie. You know, a lot of people don't want to take a chance out in Hollywood on something that, you know, is not something in their comfort zone or whatever. So I went ahead and I ended up, shooting the movie and all that. As far as harder, it hasn't been any harder because I haven't really tried yet to get the movie out there. one of the things that I think a lot of people do is they try to rush the process a little bit and start trying to really push getting distribution as soon as they finish something in the can or even before. And one thing you have to think about as independent filmmakers is you think finish and has to be really solid and really tight before you show it to anybody, because that's one of the things that I think some of the guys do is they show their raw footage or whatever to people, and you just don't want to do that because people automatically think you're amateur because they don't have any vision. You know, it doesn't matter if they're in the movie business or not. You know, so you have to have a completed film, music, sound effects, special effects, all the stuff you're going to have in there has to be ready to rock and roll. Then you show it to somebody. Then you got a shot, you know, of getting it distributed. So,
mm-hmm.
So I haven't tried yet.
So you haven't? You haven't actually tried to pitch it yet? Or?
No, I haven't tried. So I'm waiting. We're actually going to go to Sundance, me and a couple of the guys that worked on Evil Keg with me. We are putting together the trailer right now, and we're going to go out, and I'm going to there's a couple people I've already got meetings set up with, and I'm going to definitely be talking to them about Evil Keg, see if they'll be interested based off the trailer. So, and if that's the case, then that's great, but they're still not going to be able to see the movie until we're finished.
Exactly. If you're, you know, while you're at Park City, you should stop by Troma Dance, you know, because that's, like,
I'll
right by there.
Will. Oh yeah, absolutely. It's right there in the same city, right?
Yeah, it's right down the, I guess right down the street, and they've been trying to raise money and everything, and they've been trying to get it done. But you know, because a lot of the people I've met right now have worked on like Poltergeist, the new Troma movie, so
right,
and they all have been talking about how I guess Troma's just not doing so well right now. I mean, it's kind of at a low point, you know, like money wise, you know.
Right, so Troma's in a weird. I saw them out in Cannes, and they're in a weird phase. I think, man, Troma. Those guys have done such a great job of keeping their thing rolling. And I mean, you know, Lloyd Kaufman's done a great job at, you know, heading that situation to be the anti-Hollywood kind of thing. But I tell you, man, this is the thing. I think is the problem with that is that you can't fight the system forever. And unfortunately, he's been doing it so long. He's such a good job at it, but I think a little bit starting to backfire because some of the stuff that's come out, it's not, obviously it's not mainstream. It's meant to be not mainstream, but I mean even the methods he's using, like out in Cannes, are just so weird sometimes that I think it's turning some people off after a while. But I could be wrong about that. What do I know? You know.
Well, you know, I've had people that worked with Troma, like, on my show. Like, I've had, I don't know if you heard of the actor Trent Haga.
Yes, I've read Lloyd Kaufman's book, Make Your Own Damn Movie. I've read that several times. So, yeah, Trent Haga co-wrote that movie with him. Or co-wrote
exactly.
That movie with him.
Co-wrote that book with him, and he co-wrote, you know, Citizen Toxie, The Toxic
sure.
Church of Horror. And he's actually, you know, from what I've heard, he's... you know, from what he said on my show and what I've heard on the, you know, outside, is that he's written a movie recently that some Hollywood
sure.
Executives have been taking a look at and are actually going to make.
Mm-hmm.
So he can't talk about that, like, more than, you know, kind of. But he said that he's really excited and, you know, might be actually something. I believe it's Hollywood. It could be another, like, bigger independent company or whatever, but... pretty sure it's like a Hollywood kind of inside thing. So
right,
and
yeah,
so he's blown up, you know.
Yeah, you mentioned Eli Roth. I mean, there's James Gunn. I mean, Haga, maybe he's the next guy to come out of that, you know.
Yeah.
But Troma's got a lot of great talent that's come through there, and I mean, Lloyd's done a great job of, you know, like I said, promoting his stuff, and I just don't know that it's working as well as it has in the past because there's only so much you can shot people with. And I think, I mean, the guys that are watching movies today, this is one thing I think is people are a little bit kind of tired of the special effects and all the other stuff. And I could be overstepping my, you know, saying this, but I kind of feel like people are wanting to get back to some stories and wanting to get back to something that's meaningful. I think that's one of the reasons why Garden State, you know, that little movie did so well is because it touched a lot of people in that, you know, that age range. And they, it was a small, I mean, for that particular kind of movie, it was a small movie by Hollywood standards. But I think there wasn't that many special effects or anything in there. It was just kind of a story-driven movie, and I think people are wanting to get back to some of that stuff, and if you can make a clever little movie that doesn't rely on all the tricks and the splatter and all the other stuff, then it sometimes it's maybe a better way to go. You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, and to touch on, like, comedies and dramas or whatever, those are the toughest ones to sell. Like,
oh, they really are, yeah. Yeah, especially like smaller indie movies. Like, I mean, it's like you can watch a cheap horror movie and, you know, get something out of it. But it's like, you know, like sometimes, you know, like horror and comedy, I mean, you know, drama and comedy, you know, they're definitely, yeah, like definitely a lot tougher to sell.
And the worst part is somebody like a filmmaker who spends his like life writing a script that's drama, you know, and basically pours his heart and soul out into the page.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't interest people.
Right.
You know, I mean.
Yeah, it can be tough, yeah, definitely.
I mean, if it interests you, that's fine. But, you know, the most critical that I've ever gotten from people are people looking at me and thinking, you know what, that's just another Hollywood, you know, are you just trying to make another Hollywood movie because you're just ripping them off and not doing something personal. But then I do something personal and people are like, well, that's just not interesting enough. I guess your life, you know.
Yeah,
well, it's not interesting.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, you got to kind of like balance it out a little bit. Like, you have to make something that people are gonna like. Otherwise, you know, obviously no one's gonna see it. But you got to do something that kind of plays to your sensibilities, something that feels natural to you. You know, it's like, you know, you got to basically, you know, it's like we were talking about before. Like there's basically maybe, you know, like four totally original movies, and
yeah.
Like everything else is just kind of variations. Yeah, that was actually – I actually kind of had a similar problem that you did, John, was with – you know, I was writing a script called – writing a screenplay called The Third Shift. And basically, like, the premise was a bunch of night shift workers at a retail store. Like, they were gonna like, survive a zombie attack. And obviously, it's basically just kind of a variation of Dawn of the Dead.
Mm-hmm.
But, it's like, what can I do to kind of make it my own? That was kind of, like – Yeah, you know, the challenge that I was.
And then does seem kind of like somebody would, you know, a Hollywood person would go, so are you saying this is a, you know, Dawn of the Dead meets Clerks?
Yeah.
You know?
That's basically kind of how it was. But like, I decided like I didn't want to make like a zombie screenplay. Like, I wanted to make it like more about, you know, the characters and stuff and like how they face this crisis. And like, I ended up changing the zombies into like alien possessed.
You should do cannibals. Those are fun.
Something like that, yeah. They definitely be cannibals, but, you know, alien possessor or something like that. I don't know.
No.
But, yeah, I'll finish it one of these days.
So, Alan, did you do, like, a bunch of shorts before you did any features?
Unfortunately, I did do a few, and that's one of the things that I probably regret now is that I didn't do more, like, feature-length things when I had the chance. And, you know, looking back on it, it would have been easy. It would have been easy just to continue on and make a, you know, feature-length film, something I had, something I could actually sell. But, you know, now I know better. And I tell you, the one thing that, you know, I did gain some experience out of those, I guess, but not to the point where it made a big difference, I don't think. I think really, you know, you do shorts and, yeah, you get a little experience doing it, but it's all it's OJT, on-the-job training, anyways. Once you get out there, you're going to run into so many problems or whatever that you're not going to be able to, you know, thwart all those problems. And the one thing you can do is in pre-production is try to cover as many things you think are going to come up. And, you know, all those things are going to come with experience. But I do think that I did do three shorts before. And to be honest with you, I don't know that it helped me or hurt me, to be completely honest. But I do know that I've done them. But, yeah, it's I probably wouldn't show them anybody.
Well, I mean, that's, I guess, you know, that's the thing, though. I mean, if you want to make a movie and, you know, like, I guess when I was reading Robert's book, Robert Rodriguez's book, made me think about it is he said that everybody's got 100 bad movies in them.
Right.
It's a good thing to just try to get them out. You know?
Right.
And, I mean, you know, if you look at Robert's short film, Bedhead, have you guys seen that?
I have, yes.
It's been. I want to say I have, but I don't remember it at all.
Okay. Well, it was basically about this girl who she's playing. You know, she's fighting with her brother or whatever, and then she cracks her head accidentally, and then she gets all these, you know, I guess psycho powers, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, starts kind of telekinesis and stuff like that, and starts kind of using them to her advantage, and then, you know, cracks her skull again, and then wakes up, and they're still there, but she's learned her lesson about it. And it's a really good, you know, short film done on obviously a very shoestring budget, and shows that Robert had some talent before he even did. You know, before he even did, you know, El Mariachi, which was a very talented movie to begin with, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, he's incredible, and he's also the guy who's trying to pave the way to digital, you know.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, totally. You know, and I mean, that particular guy, in that book he mentions that, you know, he had been making films for years ahead of time, you know, with his dad's little VCR and stuff. He'd been doing that for a long period of time. And that's the thing, is like he had a passion for doing it, and he, you know, he just kept on at it, and then until he got to the point where he did get the Bedhead, and it got to a lot of awards and stuff, and then he went on and made that little action flick. And the cool thing is, he put an action in it. He didn't put as much like sex in it, because I don't think he was thinking about that at the time. But
he didn't put any in, actually.
But he did have those parts. I mean, the only sex parts he had, the sexy parts, was the girl in the pool, I think, in Mariachi was, you know, he had some elements of that, you know.
Yeah.
But he didn't have any, like, sex. But the whole thing is, he put together an action and a flick where he watched all those Mexican, you know, films, and he said, we can make something as good as this, you know. And that's the thing, that if you have somebody that, you know, have a standard where you see and you go, okay, if people are putting together these kind of films, I can do this. And I know, and that's important, because people like feel like it's impossible. And I had a lot of people here in Atlanta that when I started out making motorhome thought I was a nut and thought I'd never be able to make it and get it out there and distribute it. They just thought I was wasting my time and my money doing this. And, you know, it's one of those things, if you believe in it hard enough, if you think about it, concentrate and go, okay, this is what I want to do, then, and not even use the word want, this is what I am going to do, then all things change and things become, and they align in your direction and make your goals and your dreams happen for you. So it's important, you know.
Exactly. And you know, I mean, he's like you said, he had done everything until he realized he was getting awards for it, and then he did it very independently, you know, $7,000. I mean, basically he borrowed a camera off of the shoot of what's it, like Water for Chocolate. You know,
right.
This is from, like, what I remember. I mean, I'm not, like, looking back at the book or anything, but, you know, and then he just basically borrowed a camera, used, you know, himself and, like, one person as the boom person, you know, basically, and then kind of made the movie like that, you know, with, like, no crew, you know, and then not really any extras, and a Mexican town that was so small that they allowed him to, like, even, you know, film an action scene there and stuff like that, because they had nothing else going on.
Sure,
you know?
Yeah, they let them run around with guns and stuff. They police supplied them with them. Yeah, it's a crazy story, man. But that's one of the things that got him so, like, popular, is because he had this really cool story behind the movie. You know, the movie was good. It was a good movie, but, you know, it was the story behind the movie. You know, it was a $7,000, this guy that sold his body to be in this, you know, be a testing, test these drugs.
Test subject, yeah.
Yeah, test subject. And, you know, the guy was dedicated, man, and he wanted to make it happen. And that's the thing, is that if you wanted to make it happen and you have a desire to do it, you'll do it. And the money, all these other things will not get in your way if you continue to go forward with it, and you'll figure out a way around the hurdles. And what's the coolest thing is, and one thing that I found with Motorhome and with Evil Keg, that if you just say, this is what we're going to do, you're going to find a myriad of roadblocks are going to pop up
just keep on plowing through that, and you'll find that for every roadblock, there is either a way around it or somebody there to knock that roadblock down for you and supply you with something even better. So just keep on moving.
That's really what I don't like about the Project Greenlight shows, really, because the way that they work, you know, I mean, like, have you guys seen those?
I've seen bits and pieces of it. I know, like, the basic idea of it and everything.
Okay.
Yeah, I've seen parts of it. I wasn't really all that, like, I was, it's like the American Idol for filmmakers or something.
Well, what's really funny is, like, you know, the first one, Pete Jones's thing, they gave him a chance to write and direct this movie. He wrote it. They didn't even like the script originally. I mean, they thought it was the best of the worst, you know?
Yeah.
Kind of like, they were like, okay, well, all these scripts are horrible, but this one is the one that we think we could make, you know?
Yeah.
And so they end up doing it. You know, they give him all this pressure. They tell him he can't do this, he can't do that. And then on the worst of all, they give him $1 million budget, right?
Mm-hmm.
They give him $1 million freaking budget. I mean, this is Miramax, giving him $1 million. And then he still asks for more.
Yeah.
I was like, this is just, you know, come on now. I mean, what you do after that, if they screw you like that and you can't make it for $1 million, which he should have thought about it to himself, like, ooh, maybe could I make this for $1 million, you know?
Well, a lot of the guys, I mean, a lot of people don't think about the business aspect of it, and you do have to keep that in mind. And, I have people here in Atlanta that everybody wants to get paid, and everybody wants to do this. But everybody's going to ask. They're trying to get everything they can out of you as a filmmaker. They will. People think you are absolutely filthy loaded if you're making a film, you know. And you go in and say, "Hey, we'd love to be able to use your, you know, your bar for this scene in our film. Would you be interested?" Oh yeah, totally. You know, it's $1,000 a day, and you just go, "No, wait. You don't understand. We're like, you know, filmmakers that aren't really making any money doing this, and so they just don't get it, man. They just
see
think
that's
that you're
the thing.
A
you
film.
Live in Atlanta, though. I mean, Atlanta is a huge city."
Right.
I say you go to a smaller Georgia town, they're gonna be a lot nicer to you, you know, I think.
Well, herein is the problem with that. Okay, so there have been people that have done the same thing that what you're talking about. They'll people that live here in Atlanta, they'll go outside and they'll film, in smaller rural towns in Georgia, and yeah, those guys are a lot more willing to help you out. But now you've got all your crew and all your actors that are from Atlanta. Now you've got to move them all the way up there to wherever it is you're at, right? And now you only have to pay just for one meal. Now you've got three meals you have to pay for, okay? Not only that, you have to pay for their housing and any gas, anywhere they go or anything. And as a low-budget filmmaker guy, you have to go, okay, wait a minute, what am I doing here? What's important? Is it to make the film or is it to have these guys stay at the Holiday Inn, you know? So it's important. What you do is you try to make short days, short as possible, have everybody in a central location. And, yeah, Atlanta's not the most least expensive place to make a movie for sure, but you try to make it so everybody gets home and they're able to sleep in their own bed and all that other stuff so you don't have to pick up those costs. But more importantly, you know, it's just more convenient for everybody in the long run, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it's about to close up right now because after, 2 hours it ends. So, wow, I didn't realize it was, like, close to 2 hours until just recently. I was like, oh, crap.
Yeah.
And it's actually starting to really get good, too. Gosh. You know, that's the sucky part about my job is because everybody wants to talk for more than 2 hours too, like, you know.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you know, it just won't happen. So I don't make the rules. I guess, enforce them, you know.
Yep.
But did you have fun, Alan?
Oh, yeah, it was great. It was great talking to you guys. I appreciate the exposure here. And I do want to, tell everybody that we're you know, The Evil Keg is the new movie. We have www.evilkeg.com. And if you want to go on there, we have people can actually buy a copy of the movie now. And we'll put their name in the credits. It's called a pre-sale DVD. We did the same thing with Motorhome. And a lot of the people, we had hundreds actually of people buy the DVD beforehand. They got their name in the credit, which is a cool thing, man. And if it's around Christmas time, and if you want to get a real unique gift for somebody, that's kind of a cool thing to do for a movie buff. So, anyways, but it's evilcake.com, and again, like I said, Motorhome Massacre is out there in the stores. You can certainly go and check that out. So.
Okay,
awesome,
cool, yeah. I'll definitely check that out, and I'll try to buy it sometime. It's just right now it's the holidays. It's kind of hard to, you know, to buy for yourself. It's more easy to, you know, buy for somebody else too, so like you said. But, well, thank you so much, and, you know, hopefully Evil Keg will be out in the, you know, by Lionsgate as well.
Yeah. I hope so. We'll see. If not Lionsgate, somebody else. But hopefully we'll have as good a luck. And I do appreciate Chris. I appreciate you being on the phone. And Jonathan, thank you for having me on.
All right. You're welcome.
Hey,
all right, everybody.
All right.
Goodbye, okay?
All right. Take care, guys.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.